Thank you very much. So this is a great honor for me. I could say exactly the same as Arthur said. One of the many of us who benefited a lot from offers constructive criticism. And I would like to recall a saying by Giancarlo Rota in his 10 lessons I wish to have told. There are two kinds of mistakes. There are fatal mistakes that destroy a theory. But there are also contingent ones which are useful in testing the stability of a theory. So I'm not sure that Hofer agrees with this statement, but fortunately for me, all mistakes he discovered were of the second kind. So, but I did not only benefit from his correction, suggestion, and so on, but also his own work, and especially about almost ring theory. So, which is a concept introduced first by Bernd Faltings. Piedical theory, and then there is this famous book by Ramero. Which during maybe 2 or 3 years that I was involved with the application of perfectoids to commutative algebra became a kind of my bedtime reading. So they work in a very general setting. So this is what they call basic setup. Here, well, this is a ring, and this is an ideal, which is idempotent. And first goal of my talk is to explain some aspect of how useful it is to work in this generality. So, because the classical case, so the standard example is a valuative example. This is a case where, let's say, you have a K complete. Well, non-discretely valued field. Well, this is awfully ambiguous because I mean that, okay, so nothing with the topology, but the valuation is not.
Also, the valuation is valued could be in rank one of your valuation, also your valuation. And discrete can be discrete rank one or discrete rank n.
Exactly, this is. Exactly, this is what I'm saying. So I think there is some need of change of terminology. So I mean that the valuation is rank one and non-discrete. And so we have here the M in this example is just K0, 0, 0, the maximum the valuation ideal, and the V is K0. So the first instance probably where one encounters this theory. I should say one word what it is about. It's just a localization. Can define it in a few words. Mod V with respect to the Serre class consisting of modules filled by M, and so one has the localization functor, which is denoted by an A, and it has a right adjoint, which is denoted by a star, lower star, and also a left adjoint. And one can. Oh, yes. Thank you. And also the same for algebras. Going to almost algebras with a right adjoint, which is the restriction of that one, and also a left adjoint, which is different from that one. Okay, so the first instance, now you encounter this. Framework is when you consider, let's say, well, maybe I need I take any uniformizer. So K is just K naught 1/π. We start with A. Pi torsion free and pi radically complete V algebra, but here V is K-naught, K-naught algebra. Then we can construct, we can invert just this pi, and this is our Banach K algebra. And if you want to describe the unit ball of this Banach algebra for the natural norm, this is just a lower star, this one, which in this case is just K0 to A. Double zero. Okay, this is a very natural in this context. So now I specialize to case of perfectoid fields. So such a K is called perfectoid, as everybody knows here. If condition is that the Frobenius, first we assume that the residue field is of characteristic P. So Frobenius is surjective. And this is there is a very nice theorem, a deep theorem by Gaber and Ramiro, this book. That this is the same as an older notion of deeply ramified, which means that essentially the module of differential of the absolute integral closure of this K naught over K0 is almost zero. So it's killed by K double naught. So in this context, there are better choices for this pi, one can assume. That you can take any power, any fraction of power of pi, all are in that exist.
I think it's also actually zero, but I have to look up in the power, but we put several equivalent conditions.
Yes.
It's also
stronger. In any way, this one is what is called deeply ramified by Coates and Quimber.
K zero over pi is not the field.
No. You have a lot of nilpotent elements.
Yeah, but I think it is actually zero.
Ah.
But anyway.
Okay. Okay. So from now on, I assume that I can take all lots of pi, which simplifies a little bit notation. So let me describe a second instance and, with a, well, you need almost ring theory, but still in the classical evaluative instance. So that's introducing the perfect grid algebra. So A as before. So this is a K-note algebra, which is flat and periodically complex, so periodically complex. Then it's called is a perfect grid if the Frobenius induced an isomorphism between A ordered by the ideal generated by pi 1 over p to A ordered by pi. So, and now, so this condition, the injectivity is quite important. Injectivity, well, I say it one minute. Now one has a correspondence or equivalence of category between, in fact, such A's, but the almost version, so, and the A, which is A, one over B. Here you have perfectoid algebras over K, and here you have perfectoid algebra over K naught, but in the almost category. So the in the other direction is just to take a naught, which is the ring of power bounded elements. And this ring of power-bounded elements under this, the injectivity part of this condition, is itself bounded. So it's a uniform algebra. Okay, so this is a nice equivalence of category between some algebras over K and some almost algebras over K naught. Now, almost ring theory is not only categorical theory. Earlier, there was Gabriel, very general localization theory.
By the way, when you say perfectoid algebras in the almost category, it could be differencing. It could be you localize the category of perfectoid algebras relative to almost isomorphism, or you repeat the definition. That is, you have an almost algebra verifying this condition in the almost sense.
Yes.
And of course, one can show, but you have to show something.
Exactly. Exactly. Either way, it gives the same result.
Yeah, I'm not sure if Charles uses this. Okay.
No, no.
Didn't verify exactly this.
Okay.
It's because you have the shrieks, you have several large job.
Yeah. So, in this very general localization, you have such a map mod and mod A, but you have only the right adjoint. There is no left adjoint. But this is a purely categorical theory and rather simple, in fact. Whereas here, all the salt of the theory flavor is that after things. Romero develops a number of notions of non-categorical notions such that almost finiteness, almost finite, almost projective, it's not at all the categorical protein, almost etal, almost finite etal, and so on. And then this correspondence, which is an equivalence of categories, becomes problematic when one considers this kind of notions. So the end result in the theory is almost purity theorem, due in the first form by Faltings, and then Scholzer, and independently Kedlaya new, says the following. If you start with A perfectoid algebra over K, and B finite etal over A, then two things. The first thing is that B is also perfectoid. And the second thing is that that you can transfer somehow the finite etal thing through this correspondence, which means that in fact B0 A is finite etal over A note A. Or if you prefer, B note is almost finite etal over A note.
What is the category mode A or mode 0 and note? The category mode and another.
Ah, the V modules. V modules.
But when K, there is an
exponent. Yes, this is in almost categories. This is localization. So.
And also, you have an equivalence of categories.
Yes.
Absolutely, yes. So that one can also restate that this equivalence restricts or extends to a category on etal, finite etal.
And also in the more recent work, we prove this almost pure theorem is somewhat more general, slightly more general set than these open sets in open, risky open in
sure, there are several extensions. I just wanted to introduce a little bit the thing. my only small contribution to this theorem later is to remark that in fact this implies this. So in the proofs, this simplifies the thing. You just have to prove this one. So in fact, and this is using a Galois argument and also a theorem by Gaber Romero. So let me sketch this because this is useful for later purpose. So to prove this assertion, one may restrict to the Galois case, so assume that B A is Galois group G, which means the following, that A is ring of invariants of B, and if you take B tensor B over A, you get the product of G of B. So here you have just take the conjugate. I mean that this natural map is an isomorphism. So then you can consider you would like to have something similar from for B note. So but there is at least when you take the completion, there is a basic theorem and perfectoid theory, which says that this is almost B completed tensor B over B note. But since this is just finite etal and just projective, in fact, this is the same as B tensor B A note. And then you use this isomorphic, you find that this is B note. So it almost says that your B note is almost Galois, except that you have a completion here. So you, at least this implies that modulo pi to the n, then your B note over A note let me write. Is almost the Galois over a node. And in particular, it's almost finite etal. And then there is a theorem by Gaber-Ramejo that you can pass to the limit. And you find that this B node is also almost finite etal over A0. Already in the case of fields, it gives a short proof of this. So this special case. Okay, so
in the case of field, you have to know that the extension is a perfectoid field.
Yes, you have to prove that a finite extension is a perfectoid field. Which follows from the correspondence between the Galois, absolute Galois group of your perfectoid field and the one of the tilt. So. Well, it's not optimal. Okay. Maybe I'll just start here. So, but I told you that I wanted to explain how useful it is to generalize the setup like it has been done in Gaber's Ramejo's book, and not to restrict to the evaluative example. So the first instance where one, so beyond the evaluative case occurs in Scholz's Hipparchite sets, which is following some kind of perfectoid analog of Riemann's classical theorem in several complex variables. So one starts with a perfectoid algebra, and one assumes that one is given successive so sequence of right, a piece root of an element G in A0 and a not non-zero divisor. Then one can look at the level of spaces as a tubular neighborhood at its complement and at the function which are bounded by one outside the tubular neighborhood and look at what happens when epsilon tends to zero. So in terms of function, this wants to consider this localization. One consider the element of spectral norm at most one. And one version of Scholz's Hipparchite set says that the limit, so this ring of function outside the tubular neighborhood is not exactly A0, but something very similar. This is G1 over P infinity A0. So now, well, it's a little bit as in P infinity. So, so this is intersection of all G minus 1 over pi, but when you take the intersection, this is an algebra, not just a module. So it's slightly bigger than A0. But it's, up to my knowledge, it's an open problem to know whether this is perfectoid. is a basic open question in the theory. But at least it's clear that it is, it is almost isomorphic, of course, to A0, where almost is referring here to the basic setup, omega t 1 over p infinity, k 0 t 1 over p infinity. So this is m, this is v. And t is mapped to g, this story. So this is a non-valuative instance. And because of this problem, in all the story I will tell, it's quite useful to introduce a notion of almost perfectoid algebra, but almost is in the sense of omega g 1 over p infinity, almost perfectoid algebra, which is two conditions. You want that let's say over a field K. A. You want that A0 is bounded, so that the algebra is uniform, plus the fact that A0 over pi to itself by Frobenius is almost surjective. In this coarser sense, oh yes, yes, there is yes. Okay. I was thinking, yes, this is not this A, this is, I was thinking. Yeah. Okay. So, now, let me.
So it's a Banach algebra. The uniform Banach
yes.
algebra,
yes,
which satisfies this condition, where almost is taken in a coarser sense. So let me so this is the starting point of a result which I've called the perfectoid Abelian-Karp lemma. Let me speak a little bit about this. So perfectoid lemma. So it starts from the observation that if you look at the, so now it's invisible, the almost purity. So theorem. You replace the second by B, let's say finite and even flat over A, then this does not imply that B is perfectoid. So one needs to modify the construction to get something in the ramified case. And let me explain what has to be done. So one pick discriminant so a discriminant, I mean that B let's say B 1 over G is finite total over A 1 over G. I assume that it is a non-zero divisor. And so the process, I will describe it in two steps. So the first step, so the idea is to follow the Abelian-Karp philosophy, instead of just grossly inverting the discriminant, you ramified it. So in this perfectoid context, you ramify G, so take all fifth power roots, and this is done. So start from A0, and you end up with A G1 over P infinity, 0, which I denote by A0. And this was this so this how was it called this morning? I don't know. Lemma, Fessel flatness lemma. So that one can prove that at least that this is almost faithfully flat, at least mod. Mod pi to the n. So now I don't know, maybe with the modern techniques, prism, maybe you can erase some almost, or maybe some quotient, I don't know.
You have to change the power bounded element to something slightly smaller, I think. Yes.
Yes.
You have to
take, if you want to erase this, yes. Maybe so. No, but anyway, I should. What I prove is this. Anyway, this is the first step. But then, of course, you have to. Then the second step. Of course, consider B tensor zero, but this is not good. You have to replace this by. The integral closure of, for instance, a or complete integral closure of a zero hash into this b a one over pi g. I guess this, yes. Okay, so. After doing this, what you get is that, let me call it B0. This B0 is G1 over P infinity, almost finite etal over A0. Prime zero. And second, it's not like this. This one is. Yes. I was confused with the first condition is that it is almost perfectoid. And then when you take a quotient by any n, this is for any n. So, yeah, what is the strategy? The strategy is to consider this. Once you have all roots of G, and consider as before the tubular neighborhood of, and take the complement. Over the complement, so that's it. The E, let's say, is becomes finite etal, and we are in the situation of the almost purity theorem, and then to control what at the limit, one uses a variant of this Galois argument, this Galois trick which I described. There is one difference. Is that as offer 1b in due time, one cannot apply in this new situation the theorem which allows to go to the limit in L, because p does not belong to the ideal m. So one has to content oneself with this. But now, so this is probably up to my knowledge, the first instance when one really needs to go beyond the evaluative case in almost ring theory. That is almost, well, I would have never thought about it without your book, of course. Okay, so now let me, I spoke about all this almost ring theory, and now I will speak about ordinary commutative algebra, but application of these things too. So basically, it is how to remove almost from this story at the end. So let me, so application.
What's the conclusion of this Bianca lemma? You say it doesn't imply. What is the, what does
no,
it?
No, this is not the, this is the first, this is a preliminary observation. The Abiancar's lemma is the conclusion.
Yeah, of course, there are some complements. For example, if you take an Ettal algebra which is spacefully flat, then it is not, it's also almost finite Ettal and also almost spacefully flat, which is important in the conclusion.
Just say it again.
If the Ettal algebra is of positive rank,
yes,
where then the, what you get is almost finite Ettal, but also almost spacefully flat.
Yes.
Okay, and also you can describe this complete integral closure in different ways, like as the actual integral closure of what
exactly
something. And
exactly, you can replace this by, okay, by G1.
Okay,
one.
But those are results. Okay, this
okay.
Part of the
okay. Okay. Yes, yes, yes. There are many variants and or complements to this. So application to ordinary commutative algebra. So I will say a few words about Cohen-Macaulay business. So we have now, let's say, local notarian, maybe complete domain for simplicity. Okay. And we consider a system or sequence of parameters. Of parameters, which means that when you mod out by each of them, it cuts, so the dimension drops by one at each step, so d is the dimension of r, and as everybody knows, it is called regular if after, so if this map going from r x to I is injective, and R is not X R. So now, if this is true for any system of parameters, then the ring is called Cohen-Macaulay. This is a kind of paradise for commutative algebras, but one does not have this condition. One can still do a lot by considering Cohen-Macaulay algebra. So this is definition. So Cohen-Macaulay R algebra C. Yes, that's big. Is oh an R algebra is called big Cohen-Macaulay if any system parameter in R becomes regular in C.
Sometimes it's called balance.
Yes, yes, there are a lot of strange terminology. So.
I thought R is not XR. Yeah, it's not XR.
Ah, not. Thank you. Yes. Thank you. So, big refers to the fact that one does not require C to be notarian. Big means that C need not be notarian. So very useful proposition.
Any means every? Hmm? Any means any or every?
Every. So the proposition that if R is regular, then an algebra C is a Cohen-Macaulay, a big Cohen-Macaulay of R, if and only if it is facefully flat. Okay, so in many problems of homological aspect of commutative algebra, it's even if your ring is not Cohen-Macaulay, it's almost as good to have a Cohen-Macaulay algebra. For instance, let me give a kind of prototypical example of this thing, is to check whether a sequence finite of free modules of finite rank is exact or not. So example of use CM algebras. So you consider sequence of free modules over R, finite rank. So if you have this, you can consider also the CZG and the, so let's say this is phi s and so, and the ideal of minors. So ideal generated by minors of the right rank, of the expected rank. So, yeah. So. And then you can consider the codimension of this ideal. And so if exact, if this sequence is exact, then this is at least I. The converse is true if R is Cohen-Macaulay, but otherwise it's not true in general.
Exact in which, exact not at the, except for the end, you mean?
Yes, maybe, yes.
You mean you want to resolve something?
Yes, E less than S, I think. That's,
No,
it's
I bigger than
yes, bigger than zero.
So you want the not it's exactly without the zero on the
yes. Yes, you want to have this is phi one, there is no phi zero. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. So but if R is not same, in any case, this condition always implies that this condition on the ideal minor, that's the sequence tensor C is exact for any C big or not big Cohen-Macaulay or algebra. So up to tensoring by. So this is a version so of this classical Eisenbuchbaum criterion, which shows this is the importance of this. And so Huxter conjecture that any R as before has a big Cohen-Macaulay algebra. So he proved it with Wieneke. It for characteristic P. In fact, he proves that absolute integral closure works. The absolute integral closure is just the integral closure of R in some algebraic closure of the field of fraction of R. And in characteristic zero, surprisingly, this is more difficult. So one uses some kind of they use some reduction mod P and put a lot of P together and with the Schoutens, I don't know how to pronounce his name, use the ultra product argument. Ultra product of a thing of this kind, but for a reduction mod P, for P large enough of R. Okay. So, but the remaining case is a mixed characteristic, 0P. And so I established this conjecture in this case by using the perfectoid Abelian-Kerr's lemma in the following way. So you consider you have an S. Well, I call it R. Now I switch to S maybe. So local vectorian complete domain, and then by Cohen structure theorem, I can put here local, let's say of the form K. I assume I must, well, this is part of the preliminaries, may assume that the residue field is perfect. Represent S as a finite extension of a ring of this form. From a paraseries of the V ring of K. And now from R, one constructs a perfectoid, which is the completion of the union of I of your ramified P. And you ramify the variables. So you take the union of all these things and you complete periodically. So then you do the same process as before with now your B. So A is just A0, 1 over P. Your B will be S tensor R with this A. And then by the perfectoid Abelian-Kerr lemma, one gets what I describe as no, this is not here, this is hidden somewhere. Let me this. I denote by this curly B or something zero will be now this one will be P G 1 over P infinity almost two things, almost perfectoid and almost C M S algebra. What is almost Cohen-Macaulay algebra? This is the same condition as here, except that you replace, you put almost, this is well, almost isomorphic to something which satisfies this condition, for instance. But a very delicate point is that this anything which satisfies this, the first condition satisfies almost analog, but this is not true for the second condition. So maybe it was the point that I made this mistake because This is a really delicate point when you say that it is not almost this is a stronger condition. So the terminology is rather delicate and dangerous because an almost CM. It's not clear that Quine-Macaulay algebra over R is almost Quine-Macaulay. There are some general lemmas about it, but it's not automatic, far from there. Now, the problem is to remove almost. So the first thing you would think about is to use just the left adjoint functor and go to because to be a perfectoid to be a CM algebra of S for an S algebra is the same as to be Quine-Macaulay over R, and then this is the same as being faithfully plat. And this functor preserve faithful flatness. But the problem, this does not work, because if you apply this, this does not, may not contain B or S. So this is not good. You have to use other things. So what I use first is Huxter pre-existing techniques of algebra modification, which is a very formal process to you force any if you have an invented relation, you pretend it's you have a divisibility like this, then you add some variables and to force artificially to look partially Quine-Macaulay and go to the colimit, huge colimit. It works, to ensure this condition, you need to start with something which is already almost Quine-Macaulay. But this works. And recently, I understand that Hofer has a much more elegant way of using ultra power. So.
Not necessarily ultra, just product.
Ultra product?
Well, you can use ultra product, but you can just use without ultra filter, just taking sequences, more than finite sequences. Okay. You don't have to.
Okay, thank you. So, now we are, with this, we have constructed this proof, Huxter's conjecture, so, which implies a Dirac Simon conjecture, by the way.
And also, there is the previous work of Shimomoto, where he does something, Japanese guy, he does something to refer to where
in some cases. This will come in a minute, or maybe in a few seconds. So. In fact, one can do a bit better. So this, using just this trick, you get Quine-Macaulay algebra, but you lose the first condition of almost perfectoid. So the Shimomoto's idea.
In my way, after completing, you do get perfect. So it's also fixes the perfect.
So his idea was very simple. In fact, it's just a tilt, then apply Huxter modification, and then untilt, and then you get both. So at the end, if you like, this is a theorem, so I prove the existence in general, but Shimomoto proves this more refined thing, so that any local Noetherian complete domain of characteristic 0p admits a perfectoid Quine-Macaulay algebra. And okay, And there is also a complement to this due to Ma and Schwede, is that those perfectoid CM algebras form a filter system.
Yes. Two can be dominated.
Yes. Two of them can be dominated by two. Yes. Maybe there is. Well, I don't know the terminology. And there is another theorem, which was also conjecture by Huxter, to kind of weak functoriality. So. So I proved this a few months ago, I think. So this says that if you have a R to prime, the local homomorphism of local Noetherian complete domains of any characteristic, then there exists a diagram like this, with C and C prime, CM algebra over R and R prime, respectively. So this, for instance, can be used to prove that corollary of this is that any
C and C prime are perfectoid.
In the case of mixed characteristic case, yes, one can take them to be perfectoids. If one of them is of characteristic P, one can assume that it is perfect. And there are some better results. And this proves that any subring of a regular local domain, let's say, which is a direct summand as a module over itself, is a Cohen-Macaulay ring. In fact, this corollary was proven, in fact, before this theorem, by a version due to Ma and Heitmann of weak functoriality, just exactly what one needs to get this corollary. So, okay, I have just 2 minutes, I guess. So maybe since it fits very nicely to these things, let me mention also a very nice result by Bat Iyengar and Ma, mixed characteristic analog of Kuntz theorem, just the statement. So Kuntz, so here, this is related to Cohen-Macaulay because of this property. If you have a regular local ring, an algebra is Cohen-Macaulay. It's faithfully flat. Now we consider faithfully flat extension of regular ring. So if you have any local, let's say local, maybe to this situation, I simplify a bit, complete domain, then if it is a characteristic P, know that in fact you can construct 1 over P infinity. And this is faithfully flat over R, so this is a characteristic P, if and only if R is regular. So this is Kuntz one possible formulation of Kuntz regularity criterion. So now the theorem by Margav and his co-author, so is mixed characteristic analogs, so characteristic that in fact R admits a perfectoid. I put some quotation mark because it's perfectoid in a slightly generalized sense. There is no perfectoid field behind. So faithfully flat extension if and only if R is regular. So, okay, thank you.
Questions from the speaker?
You didn't speak about the tariff closure.
Okay. Well, maybe, okay. Tight closure theory is something developed by Uxter and Yonicki, following their theorem about existence of big Cohen-Macaulay algebra in characteristic P. It's a kind of closure of so it's an idempotent completion process. First, an ideas of a given ring or modules, and which is very useful. I explained a lot of things in the study of singularities in characteristic P. Now, using those two theorems, those two persons, Marian Schrader, are developing a theory of a kind of analog mixed characteristic zero of tight closure theory, which allows to, so this is work in progress, but it seems that it allows to do whatever tight closure theory did in characteristic P in this new context. So I have no time to explain the many consequences of this powerful theory. So.
Further questions? Let's thank the speaker again.